Welcome to episode 48 of Anchored in Education. I'm E. Scott England, and Anchored in Education is the podcast dedicated to all things education. Educators across the world routinely engage in conversations surrounding fundamentals, concepts, and new ideas that improve this great profession. Sometimes we agree, other times we disagree. But at the end of the day, we are all anchored in education. Back on October 7th, episode 31 featured retired Navy captain and best-selling author David Marquet. During that episode, we discussed his first book, Turn the Ship Around. I gave it my highest recommendation, but you don't have to take my word for it. It also has been praised by authors Stephen Covey and Simon Sinek, as well as been called one of the best 12 business books of all time by the USA Today. While I'd agree with them, I would also say it is one of the most important books for educators as well. If you haven't checked out that episode, I recommend you do so. It will be well worth your time. Towards the end of that episode, though, David talked a little about his new book set to release tomorrow on February 4th. It is called Leadership is Language: The Hidden Power of What You Say and What You Don't. As he was describing the book for the Anchored in Education listeners, I knew immediately I would need to get him back on the podcast. Thankfully, when we were done recording, he graciously agreed to return. Being fortunate enough to receive an advanced copy, I can tell you that this book will be well worth your time again. But don't take my word for it. Let's hear from the author. David, welcome back to Anchored in Education.
Thanks, Scott, for having me back on your show.
We're happy to have you back, and we're excited to talk about this new book, because when you joined us last on Anchored in Education in October, you gave us a little glimpse of the new book set to release tomorrow, Leadership is Language. And so before we jump into the book, can you tell us how you came up with the idea to write about this book and what your hope was in publishing it?
Sure. So my first book, Turn the Ship Around, I told a story of how, as a submarine commander, we made these small changes in language, which had this really outsized impact in terms of ownership, responsibility, initiative, empowerment, proactivity. And language is a natural thing for a submarine commander to focus on. If you're about to shoot a torpedo, and at the last minute, you're not 100% sure that you got the right ship, and you say, hold fire, but someone sneezes on hold fire, on the hold.
Yeah.
And the weapons officer just hears fire, and they push the button. So you have to figure out a way to say that with minimizing the opportunity of misinformation, because you don't, lives are at risk. So we spent a lot of time listening to the language, and now I've been working with companies, and it's always the same thing. It's like, what's the language? Why do we say the words we say? Why do we say them the way we say them? And we started coming up with this big, don't say that, say this, or don't say it that way, say it this way. And a lot of these are fairly simple. So for example, instead of asking, someone comes to you and says, hey, I think we should delay the product launch, or I think we should give this client a discount. Are you sure? Because that's a binary question. It really forces them into a pickle, because
sure,
they got to say yes or no, and you don't really learn a lot. And so the idea would be, how sure are you? 60, because 60% is different than 90%.
Yeah.
So we started coming up with this big list of don't say it this way, say it that way. And that's sort of what this book is. But the key is, no one's going to remember a list of 40 don't say this, say that. So there needs to be a structure. And what we ended up doing was kind of uncovering what I think is some deeper structures in our language. And just to let the cat out of the bag, basically we use industrial age language.
Yes.
And if you're using language that sounds normal, like we're going to be a can-do organization, we're going to have an all-hands meeting, you're using industrial age language in strong but subtle ways. It anchors you in the industrial age. And so we need to use new language, and it will sound weird. The reason it sounds weird is because it's not industrial age language. And so a lot of this is the new language. And it's about thinking. It's about how to get people to think, not just do. And this, so we have to balance this dance between doing and thinking at work, in our education, in our lives.
Sure. And in the book, you introduce us to six new leadership plays, as you're kind of alluding to, as well as contrasting each one of the new plays to the old plays, which you just talked about. The old playbook, we could say, arose out of the industrial age era. And yeah. So we are going into the new leadership plays a little bit more. But first, I think it is important to understand what you call red work and blue work.
Yeah. So this started on the submarine. We would have all these areas, starting the reactor, loading the torpedoes, submerging the submarine, where I wanted people to be focused. I wanted them to comply. And I wanted the minimum amount of variability from the procedure. I just wanted people to follow the procedure as precisely as possible. But then there was decision work. When are we going to load a torpedo? Which torpedo will we load? What team are we going to use to do it? And for this kind of work, I wanted kind of a heads up, scanning the horizon, looking at all lots of alternatives, and embrace the variability. And so the work on the submarine, and my hypothesis is that this is common throughout organizations, bounces between decision work, which I'm going to call blue work, creative work, cognitive work, and the action of doing the thing. And so we go back and forth between the two of them. One of the key differences is the relationship to variability. Blue work and creative work, it benefits from variability. Variability is an ally. But when it comes to manufacturing or getting the right answer on the math test, we're now in red work. There is a right answer, and there's only one, and that's the one we're looking for. And so variability is an enemy to red work. And it's this relationship with variability, which really requires us to act in different ways, run meetings in different ways, talk in different ways.
And again, looking at the industrial age, you know, if we think of blue work as the thinking, the planning, like you said, the creativity, and red work is the doing, you know, and then going back, it used to be that we had just a handful of people, and we can, you know, I think we use sometimes the term ivory tower. That's where they are. They're doing the thinking and the creating, and then everybody below them is doing the doing, the red work. And we did not see that. We didn't see them intermix and mingle very well. It was simply I'm a blue thinker, I'm a blue worker, and I'm a red worker. And what your book is trying to do is tell them that we need to bring these together. We need to be able to, as a whole, as a unit, go in and out of blue and red work together in order to be most effective.
Exactly. That's the key difference. In the old ways, we did blue work, we did red work, but it was divided by class. And we have labels like management and worker, white collar, blue collar. And we have these labels and these cultural symbols to indicate which team you're on. And most of the people were in the doing class. But we know now that humans are better doing if they get to think as well. So the catchword is, let the doers be the deciders. But if all they're doing is thinking, then the work never gets done. But if all they're doing is doing, we're never improving the work, and we're never thinking about the work. So we now need people who only needed to be focused, only needed to view variability as the enemy, and never were asked to judge their own work. Now, every once in a while, we say, okay, stop. This Friday, we're going to shut down the line, and we're going to think about how to make it better. We're going to think about, we're going to come up with some new ideas. We're going to embrace variability. And oh, by the way, even though we were the ones that decided how to set it up for the last 3 months, we're going to criticize ourselves. And this requires a whole different set of skills and a whole different set of language. than the old way where I said, oh, well, my boss will come and figure out how to make it better. And I'm not asked to be self-evaluative. So all these things play into it. And this is the fundamental. So the fundamental thing now is we need to oscillate between blue and red. So that's where these plays come in. Because if I'm in red, I act one way, and then I have to get out of red and go to blue. Then I make a decision, a commitment, I go back into red, and so forth. So that's where this playbook idea came from.
All right. And here are the new plays. They are control the clock, collaborate, commit, complete, improve, and connect. And so we're going to start with controlling the clock. And in the past, we have seen our blue, and I guess I should say, I gave those new plays in order, and we're going to go through them in order because that's how they're set up. And so in the past, we've seen our blue workers doing the thinking and the red workers the doing, as we talked about. And so we can envision it as someone saying, go, and the red workers taking off, only stopping when told. So explain how controlling the clock can help us exit red work for a much needed evaluation.
Exactly. So the primary play in the industrial age was obey the clock. Because it was X units of work per time. And that's why we would pay people by the hour. That's why we clock in. That's why we have the phrase like clockwork. It's because of this sense of obeying the clock.
Sure.
And for manufacturing, that's okay. The problem is when you have people, the doers, obeying the clock, you're there and very focused. I got to get it done. When things start to change, first of all, they might not even notice the environment around them change. Blockbuster didn't notice the environment of how people were accessing movies wasn't changing.
Right.
And so what happens is we're so focused, we don't notice it. Then if we do notice it, the pressure is to obey the clock, not to say time out. But what we need now is, and if someone were to say time out, it rested on leadership to call that.
Right.
So they had to notice. But now we want to make it easy for someone who sees a problem while in red work to say time out. And even better, if we can structure it so we say, you know what, we're going to do this for 3 months. We're going to do it for a year. And then at the end, academics has a natural timeout.
Right.
You have at a very broad level, you have 1 year, you go through, I'm not implying there's no thinking during the school year, but you have the action of delivering education. And then you have a break where you can pause, reflect, see how you did, make tweaks for the next year. So this is all there is to it. It's not any more magic than that. But this cycle recurs. It recurs at big levels, like in your life. You may work, do something, have a career for 20 years. Then you take a year off. You go back to school. You figure something out. You do something different. And then you go back into the work. And it occurs at very, very, very small levels. Maybe even like just before you turn a switch or a knob, you inject a moment of thinking, blue work, and you make a decision. Yeah, this is the right thing to do. Then you turn the knob. So this is the rhythm. And now, in order to get people to think, because when we put people under time pressure, our prefrontal cortices go dark, and it's very hard to get the best cognitive work out of people. So the leader needs to say, or the team needs to say, or we need to have a structure that says, okay, time out, everyone. Put your pencils down. Let's just think about what we're doing.
Yeah.
And so that's why we call it obey the clock.
Sure. And so the new play, controlling the clock, it allows us to exit that red work. And so now we have entered back into blue work. And so our first play, once we're back in blue work, is collaborate. And so the contrasting industrial age play here would be coercion. And so I appreciated in this chapter that you mentioned that collaboration does not equal harmonious conversation. Instead, because right, that's what we think. But instead, we want to work towards an accurate picture of reality. So can you go into collaboration a little bit more?
Yeah, sure. So the idea is in collaboration is we're tapping everybody's brain, which means I need to run the meeting. in a way that makes it easy for everyone to speak up, especially the quiet people, and especially the people who think and see things differently from the group. So when you walk in there, and I've seen this 100,000 times, you walk in there and say, hey, I think we should, we should have the Boeing 737 MAX software should be certified. What do you guys think? And then people have a short conversation, and then there's a little vote, and of course everyone agrees with the CEO.
Yeah.
Then we say, oh, did we collaborate? People will say, oh yeah, we did. This is not collaboration. This is coercion.
Coercion at its finest.
Yeah, it's coercion at its finest. Now that's kind of a nasty word, but I use it deliberately because I really want to make the case we're using influence, power, or rhetoric, or something to get the world, get what we think is the right answer, as opposed to be truly curious about what everyone thinks. So true collaboration starts with asking people what they think before we contaminate them with discussion. So we could say, how confident are you in the launch date? Or how sure are you? And it's always a how question. Start the question with how.
Okay.
Because that makes it a probabilistic question. How sure are you that the assumption, that this assumption upon which this whole thing is based, will come true? And how sure are we that there are weapons of mass destruction in Iraq? Not, oh, yeah, sure, there are weapons of mass destruction. Yeah, a lot of people said, well, not really. And in the intel community, just like weathermen, say, well, they provide these hedges. But that's complex thinking. That's heavy lifting. And so the natural tendency, well, I got to simplify it to a yes, no, which dumbs down really, truly complex things and does us no service.
Okay. And so I think that's a great explanation on collaboration. And again, the comparison to coercion, because I think that is often we confuse that so much. And we really need to work more on true collaboration. So the result of effective collaboration is commitment. And so, as you mentioned, if we would have focused on collaboration instead of coercion, we would instead be looking at compliance rather than commitment. Or if we would have, I guess, focused on coercion instead of collaboration, we'd be looking at compliance rather than commitment. So for the commit play, we are now looking to leave the blue work again and go back into red work. Let's talk about the helpful tool of could, would, and should.
So, yeah, exactly this. So the idea is when you get collaboration, you get internal commitment to go to it. So, again, this is one little language thing. So sometimes people are reluctant to share what they think, or they're not 100% sure what the right path forward is. So I'd say I do this could, should, would. And so the idea is, okay, well, what could we do? Well, we could do, and you list four or five different things. Okay, what should we do? So now we're sort of narrowing it down and saying, it's a step forward from what I could do is sort of agnostic. It's just a menu. What should we do? Now I'm kind of putting it out there to say, yeah, I think this option is better than the others. And then what would you do? Now that moves it to action. Okay, well, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to make a commitment that the next time A happens, I'm going to respond in manner B rather than the way I used to, or that I'm going to start some new activity or stop some activity. So the idea is move from what feels safe but doesn't have a lot of ownership and involvement to something that feels like it has a lot of more ownership and involvement and a bias for action, but it's inherently feels less psychologically safe. So that's why we go in that order, could, should, would.
Okay. And so by now, I'm hoping that our listeners can see how moving in and out of red work and blue work create more effective teams. And so we just committed to the move back into red work, and now it is time to complete, which we could say is to exit the red work and move back into blue work. And when people have the opportunity to get the book tomorrow, when they get to page 170, they'll see kind of a table that you have where early on in the project, it is kind of like an in-out, and with the planned pauses. And as we become more comfortable in the project, or we go later on, those pauses are longer. But in the beginning, it is kind of an in-out. And but they'll see, like I said, those transitions, they're pre-planned. So we discover in the complete chapter that it is important to celebrate. And so can we spend a minute or two talking about the complete play?
Yeah, and I think this is something that we kind of we miss this on almost a daily basis. The industrial age play was continue. You wanted to run the production line as long as possible, and interruptions were frowned upon. Versus now, what I think is more helpful is to think of the work in chunks. And one of the key decisions is how long is the chunk of work going to be. So, for example, we are working with a big company to develop a new, it's a 1-week frontline leaders course.
Okay.
And we're going to go through a couple thousand. We're going to give the course 100 times in the next 3 years. So, but the first time we give the course, we only give it once, and then we stop, we ask people how it went, we take feedback, and then we make some tweaks. And then the next course, we give it again. So another, giving the course is the red work, getting the feedback and thinking about how to make adjustments is the blue work, and then we give the course again. So you're making adjustments every course, but now we've done about six of them. So now we're going to do 4 courses. So we can do a longer period of red work, and then we're going to collect data across all 4, and then we're going to do a tweak, and we'll probably do 2 of those, and then we're going to do like 7 courses, and then 20 courses. So at the beginning of the project, where there's more variables, you want to have more blue work interruptions and shorter periods of red work. Toward the latter part of the project, once you kind of got it down, that's when you're going to really get the work done. But you still need every once in a while to have some blue work. But the ratio of red to blue changes over the project.
Which is very clear to see in the book.
Yeah. So that's the idea of this concept in terms of thinking about the work as complete. And the key thing about complete is it allows you to celebrate. If you never feel like you did anything and got to any finish line, there's never a celebration. And if there's never a celebration, then there's no positive psychological reward for what we did. And then it just feels like a slog. Every day is a slog. Every day is the same as every other day. And it's not fun.
Yeah.
And we don't activate the best in humans. So, and I've been guilty of this myself. So the typical thing is someone brings you something and say, oh, great, but can we make it better?
There you go. Yeah.
Just say that's great. And then invite them to tell their story. This is the thing that's wrong with that. You didn't rest enough on the celebration. Letting them tell, hey, how did you come up with this? What was really hard about it? What were some of the key decisions you made? What were you inspired by? Let them talk about it a little bit. I mean, it depends upon how big of a thing it is they came up with.
All right.
But let them talk about it, because that will do two things. One, they'll feel the visibility. They'll feel being heard. They'll feel the respect that you have as a leader, and you'll get more of those good behaviors. But at the same time, you're going to learn what it took for them to do it. And there was probably more involved than you probably know.
Oh, hands down. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I in reading, you know, you gave some examples in your book of organizations or leaders that did not really celebrate. And it's deflating. It's deflating when you do something of significant matter, like you say, and it's not recognized. And
no one notices.
Yeah, absolutely.
No one notices.
So, all right, on to the homes.
Go
ahead.
This gets me excited because in the Navy, we would say your reward is no punishment.
Right. Yeah, and that's not how it works.
No,
All right. So on to
the
home stretch.
You will not get the best
now.
Out of people.
No, we won't.
Doing that. Yeah.
We won't. The home stretch here, we must first complete the cycle with the improve play. And so if we're looking at the alternate industrial age, we're looking at prove. And so the new play is improve. I'll just tell you, this hands down was my favorite chapter and one of the easiest to connect to education, because it seems like leaders in education tend to see what is happening in the classroom when a new initiative has started, and they want to, as you say, quote unquote, help. And, you know, I even did the air quotes there because we want to help. But I feel like you are going to tell us that we need to resist that temptation. And so when is it a good time to run the improve play?
The idea of the improve play is that we look at our own work or our own project and we pause to make it better. Now, one of the things you can get seduced into as a leader, and I've done it, is you start the team on a project and then 10 seconds later you go, oh yeah, and you have a new idea. Or you see them doing it. You see, and once you see the thing in action, then you go, I didn't foresee that. You know what, blah, blah, blah. The problem is that's perceived by the team as what you're being whipsawed back and forth. And I call it the good idea fairy.
Yeah.
And so what you need to do is just have the discipline. So if you've pre-planned the next pause, if you've done the control of the clock and said, you know what, we're going to try this, and you're going to try this experiment. Don't use the word initiative. We're going to try this experiment for 2 weeks. I want everyone to think about how it goes, including me. And I'm going to just keep my own notes. And then in 2 weeks, on Friday afternoon, we're going to get together for an hour. We're going to talk about it. Now you level the playing field. People can focus on the work as opposed to feeling whipsawed and back and forth.
Sure. All right. So we have a final play, and that is connect. In the industrial revolution age, this play was called conform, or as you point out, and we even talked a little bit about this first, hierarchy first. But that's, we need to move away. We need to go to our new playbook here. And I'm hoping that you can explain for listeners how the connect play is all about caring.
So over and over again, we see these industrial accidents. For example, Asiana 214. This is the 777 that came in low into San Francisco, and hit the seawall. The tail of the end of the airplane spun around violently. The tail end broke off. 3 people died. Now, when you listen, when you read the transcript of the cockpit recording, as the plane's coming in low, and there's evidence that the pilots know about it. But there are these long periods of silence, and there's never you're like screaming at the transcript. There's never this, hey, I need some help. Hey, I've lost it here. Hey, what do you see? And why is that? It's because everyone has got this sort of conforming to their role. I'm the captain. I'm the pilot. You're the co-pilot. Whatever it happens to be, and this holds us back. Connection. This was very hard to write about because connection means I care about the people on my team, and they know I care, and it makes it safe for them to say, you know what, I'm lost. I don't know what I'm doing here. I'm worried about making a mistake on this, or I think we might have just done something wrong. Without that sense of caring, and there's no safety, and people won't speak up. And you will never know if someone saw something and chose not to speak up. You will never know that they went through that calculus. So it's really, really, there's 2 things. That's number one. It's really, really important. And the second thing is, we know from science now that decisions, at the end of the day, all decisions are linked to emotions. We want to think, oh, we're truly rational and all that kind of thing. But when you look at the most important decisions people make, what house to buy, who to marry, that kind of thing, what job to get, there's so many uncertainties that at the end of the day, they say it just feels right. That's the kind of words people say.
Yeah.
Because emotions are key to decision-making. And if we want her team to get into thinking, which means decision-making, then we've got to let emotions into the workplace. This sort of sterile workplace where we all go into our shells and pretend like we're not really human beings, but a bunch of robots. This was because of the industrial age. This does not work when we want people to think and make decisions.
Yeah, because in the industrial age, we were looking at conformity. And that's, you know, the new play, connecting, when we talk about caring, completely different. And I heard you say something that I think, and I've mentioned this before, I think one of the most powerful things one can say is, I don't know. And you can't stop there. You can't say, well, I don't know, and then, you know, just never go. You have to follow it up with how you're going to find out. But, you know, we don't operate in silos. That's just not how organizations work. And we're not just talking education. We're talking anything right now. But for somebody that is, say, what the industrial age would call hierarchy, to be able to say, I don't know, and, you know, let's find the solution together, that's powerful.
Yeah, or let's run an experiment or look it up or whatever it happens to be. But this hit me in the face as a submarine commander, because at the last minute I got shifted to a different ship and I went there. And I didn't know. I would normally know how every button worked, but I didn't know. And early on, I was faced with this question, and I had a choice to make. I could have kind of pretended to know and had a mask on, and I just said, for some reason, I just said, yeah, I don't know. And they looked at me like, well, yeah, you're the captain. You're the captain. Like, yeah. But I saw was it was so powerful, because that opened the door to learning. They were able to say, I don't, if the captain can say, doesn't know, I can say, I
right.
don't know. And so because we stopped pretending to know stuff that we didn't know, we actually learned it.
Yeah. No pretending.
Saying I don't know is the key to getting smarter.
It is. It seems silly, but it's true. That's absolutely true.
Yeah.
All right. Hey, before we go, you reference a book titled The Wisdom of Crowds. And so knowing what we know now from our new playbook we just went over, what can you tell us about the wisdom of loud versus the wisdom of the crowd?
Yeah, so I'm referencing James Surowiecki's book, The Wisdom of Crowds, and he talks about the conditions under which the crowd is smarter than any individual person. Now, crowds can also be misled into the wrong conditions, but in the right conditions, groups can be smarter than any individual in the group. The problem is, when we have a meeting, we think we're getting the wisdom of the crowd. But if you run the meeting in the way most meetings are run, hey, what does everyone think about this? And then someone chimes in. What you're really getting is the wisdom of the loud, i.e. the first person to talk or the most outspoken person. Because that with the first person to speak, whether they want to or not, anchors the group.
Yes.
And then the group starts to coalesce around a position. And the people who feel differently than that, it just makes it harder and harder and harder and harder for them to speak up, especially if they tend to be quieter. And so what we end up with is then they just stay quiet, and we end up being deprived of this diversity of views. We've worked hard to get a diverse group of people into the room, but then we run the meeting that makes it hard for those diversities of intellectual perspective to come out. So we're acting against ourselves. So what you want is the wisdom of the crowd, but it has to be, and Surowiecki points this out in his book, the way you do it, first of all, a diversity of background is key. But the second thing is independent perspectives. And when someone anchors the group by saying, well, I think this, what do you all think? You just lost independent perspective, and you're now not going to get the wisdom of the crowd.
Right. And especially if that first person to speak is higher, one of the executives or administrator or whatever, then it becomes even that much more difficult to challenge what was initially said.
Exactly.
All right. David, I just thank you for coming back to talk about this new book, Leadership is Language, The Hidden Power of What You Say and What You Don't, set to be released tomorrow on February 4th. And I'll have a link to the book so they can go and order it, because it's one we need to be putting on our shelves.
Well, thank you so much. And thanks for having me back on your show. And thanks to all your listeners for what they do to make the world a better place. Cheers.
It is always a pleasure listening to Captain David Marquet speak. I was simply fascinated with Turn the Ship Around, and now Leadership is Language proudly goes on my leadership bookshelf and on my official recommendation list. So you can find David on Twitter by searching at @LDavidMarquet. You can also read more about David, as well as find a link to his website on my website, escottengland.com. And of course, find a link to Leadership is Language, out on my birthday, February 4th. Before I wrap up today's episode, let me remind you once again to subscribe to Anchored in Education on whatever platform you get your podcasts. I have mentioned before, but Turn the Ship Around was one of the first books I read when I transitioned into leadership. The book was actually a gift from my pastor here in Fairfield. Little did he know how much of an impact it would have on my leadership philosophy. Or, maybe he did know, which is why he gifted it. Either way, it remains one of the best books I've ever read because the message is so simple and clear. Yet I feel that even with the best intentions, we often fall into old leader-follower models. When David told me about Leadership as Language, I knew that it was going to be another one of those books that can have a tremendous impact on the way we go about education. And this message isn't just for superintendents or principals, it's a message for all educators. David again weaves stories at the beginning of each chapter that helps you see how this applies in so many areas and in every profession. Order your copy of Leadership is Language today. Reading it can have a substantial impact on how we proceed in education. It will also give value to everyone involved, from students to administration, which is important because at the end of the day, we are all anchored in education.